Not surprisingly, sibling and peer relationships are poor, and these are kids who are prone to pretty wild tantrums. You've seen the t-shirts, plays well with other children, does not play well with other children. These guys would qualify for the do not play well with other children t-shirt. They do have this very misleading appearance of normality. To most adults, the readily observable behaviors of these kids are not that extreme. There are subtle signs that they're odd or negatively different, but certainly with the denial factor that Gavin talked about. And denial, it is the most simplistic of all human defense mechanisms, but it is also the most potent. I ran one of the largest drug and alcohol treatment programs in the state of Maryland for about 10 years. So I was daily locked in mortal combat with the phenomena of denial, where people would have these horrendous substance abuse problems that far away from the tip of their nose and they couldn't see it. Here's what they look like as teenagers. No evidence of severe apparent mental disorder such as schizophrenia, autism, severe mood disorder, or attention deficit disorder. Academic performance is average to above, and I spoke about how the failing grades, substance abuse, and conduct disorder are the things that bring about intervention. Again, these are good students generally. There is typically some decline in the academic performance in the period prior to the violent acting out. Like the adult who goes postal, the workplace avenger, these kids do not have impressive criminal records or histories of delinquency. They're generally not well known to the police. As I mentioned, we can learn a lot from business and industry that has a 10 to 15 year head start in dealing with workplace violence. Early on, what business and industry would do if they identified someone that they were concerned about is they would send them to the employee assistance program. They have learned that that doesn't work very well because typically employee assistance counselors are not well versed in assessing violence with people who don't have first rank predictors. The other thing they would do is they would do a criminal background check. We have this employee down in shipping and he's talking about his gun collection and he's making reference to other shooting incidents, run a criminal background check on him. Well, what do you think they find when they run a criminal background check? Nothing. They don't have a criminal background history. The employer then breathes a sigh of relief. They now know that that was the wrong thing to do. They now know in business and industry that they were looking in the wrong places. And even though it's useful to do a criminal background check, you should not feel reassured if you don't find anything. Typically after the fact with the teenage shooters, it's discovered that they have been involved in a lot of covert vandalism and excessive secretiveness and cunning forms of dishonesty. They are immature, socially inadequate loners. They may be infatuated with a female student, and some of them did engage in stalking behavior of females. And I explained to you before that scenario of the young girl who innocently makes a positive overture but then becomes a victim because of that. They prefer young children, and even though they're well into adolescence, they're still playing soldier and G.I. Joe. The boy we saw in Maryland, the fellow that I did the forensic evaluation on, he lived in on a court, and there were other families with younger children, and that's who he hung around with, and he would get in the backyard and play soldier with them, even though he was already 15 years old. They are rejected by the mainstream students. If they are part of a group, it's a group of other kids who are outcasts, who are social outcasts, and what holds them together is some kind of common interest in a non-mainstream nihilistic philosophy, religious beliefs, whatever. The normal adolescent pastimes bore these kids, and they're very resentful of peers who excel. And as we talked a little earlier, Columbine was not the only place where the high-profile students ended up as targets. They have an interest in guns and bomb making, covert action, assassinations, media portrayals of real or fictional violence. They're on the internet and they've downloaded the notorious Jolly Roger cookbook that has all the recipes for murder, mayhem, bomb building, and assassination. Clinically, this is what you have. Average to above average IQ, what are called cognitive functions, such as memory, attention, concentration, abstraction, concept formation, all of that is well within normal limits. These are very bright kids. You can't put together these kinds of complex scenarios and plan these things out successfully and execute them successfully unless you're reasonably intelligent to begin with. There are no signs of psychosis or what I would call apparent mental illness. They're not mentally retarded, learning disabled, or brain damaged. Their thinking style is rigid and inflexible. And for those of you who have teenagers, you're thinking to yourself, so what else is new? But with these guys, it's well beyond that of normal adolescence. Their mood is depressed. These kids are depressed, and I'm preemptively alluding to diagnosis. But they are not depressed the way adults get depressed. Adults get depressed with subjectively sad mood. They are tearful. They have vegetative signs such as insomnia, loss of appetite, and low energy. With these kids, you have an atypical depression that's manifested with what we call action equivalence, namely sullen, angry, irritable behavior. They become reclusive. There are temper outbursts, destruction of property and vandalism, stubbornness, derogation of others, excessive risk-taking, and suicidal ideation. These action equivalents of depression appear to increase in both frequency and intensity prior to the shooting incident. They are non-delusionally paranoid. By that I mean they're very suspicious, hypervigilant kids, distrustful, particularly of authority, but they don't have well-established delusional systems, as is the case with people who are psychotically paranoid. They anticipate rejection and project blame. They don't accept any responsibility for the problems they have. It's all somebody else's fault. They have a victim mentality. They're very insightless kids who lack coping skills for dealing with emotions and conflict. Higher functioning students ridicule them and see them as inept. They have unstable self-esteem that fluctuates from grandiosity to feelings of worthlessness. And their sexual identity confusion well beyond that of normal adolescence. And a number of these kids were engaged in strange sexual behavior. The older of the two boys at Jonesboro was known to have molested some young children. The boy that we saw was involved in very strange sexual activities, and this apparently is true of some of these other kids as well. Their motive is vengeance. They have a rich fantasy life with revenge and retaliatory triumphs as themes. There's mental rehearsal during which they select their victims, witnesses, the time, place, and location, means, and course of action. We also now know that there are, in many cases, is extensive behavioral rehearsal. Predatory aggression, and again, let me just follow up on the behavioral rehearsal in the case in Maryland. We had this meeting, and the state police and I were very much in favor of nabbing this fellow, but the prosecutor was concerned that he didn't have enough probable cause, and it wasn't going to look good in front of a judge. And I mentioned that I had done this profile, the Unabomber profile, where portions of it were used in the search warrants. So to make a long story short, they nabbed this kid. They went into the house, and they found firearms, bomb-making material. And one of the things this boy had done in terms of rehearsal is he had a digital video camera, and he had gone to the school after hours and videotaped the school and downloaded it on his computer, and then he constructed the shooting on the computer, where he was going to be. He put crosshairs on various windows and doorways and things like that. He's in custody in Maryland at this point. This is predatory aggression. It is very selective and calculating, premeditated. There is sophistication and creativity. The Menninger triad is present. Carl Menninger a psychiatrist, a member of the Menninger family, a family that proves that psychiatry is genetically transmitted. There's about six generations of psychiatrists, and they established the Menninger Clinic in Topeka, Kansas. He wrote a book many years ago entitled Man Against Himself. The book is about suicide. In the book, he talks about the three violent wishes: the wish to die, which is suicidal; the wish to kill, which is homicidal; and thirdly, the wish to be killed, which those in who are in law enforcement recognize as suicide by cop or victim-precipitated homicide. Menninger said that if a person has one of these wishes, you need to be concerned they may act on it. However, if they have two of these wishes, the likelihood that they will act increases very significantly. If all three are present, it is virtually certain they are going to act in a violent way. This is a formulation that I use in hostage barricade incidents. I'm on the hostage negotiation team for Maryland State Police, Baltimore County Police, and when I'm called to a scene, the very first thing I try to do is determine where this person is, where the bad guy is on the Menninger triad. If he's in there saying, I have my wife and children and I'm going to kill them, and after I kill them, I'm going to kill myself, and if you try to stop me, you're going to have to kill me. In those cases, I immediately notify the tactical commander, you're probably going to have to go tactical on this one. We hardly ever are successful in talking these guys out when the Menninger triad, when all three elements of the Menninger triad are present. It is very predictive on the short term of violence. And these kids, the school shooters, have all three elements of the Menninger triad. They are all homicidal, suicidal, and they're prepared to go down in flames in a suicide by cop. The psychiatric diagnoses, these are the two that we came up with: atypical depression on axis one. Axis two is a mixed personality disorder with paranoid, narcissistic, and antisocial features. And incidentally, these were the two diagnoses assigned to Michael Carneal before we had published our study. Here's the context. The things that are going on in this kid's life shortly before the actual shooting. Typically, there are some recent multiple psychosocial stressors occurring within about 2 weeks to 24 hours of the shooting. Harris had been rejected by the Marine Corps about 3 days before the shooting. The Marine Corps must be a kinder, gentler Marine Corps, because Gavin's right. In my day, this is what they were looking for. They were looking for killers. These psychosocial stressors take the form of some type of real or imagined loss. The imagined loss is the girlfriend who was never a girlfriend in the first place. Some type of rejection or discipline, frustration, or humiliation. Specific triggers include reprimands or discipline by parents or school authorities. The reprimand can be a trivial kind of reprimand. But in a number of cases, the kid was reprimanded by a teacher in a public area a day or so before the shooting. There's some type of incident of public ridicule or humiliation or treatment perceived as unfair, the loss of a real or imagined relationship, some type of hostile rejection, teasing, or bullying by peers. The media triggers. And remember what David Phillips said, any type of high profile and novel, innovative violence or criminality or self-destructive behavior will always produce a copycat effect. But there also is some copycat influence from fictional accounts of violence in various types of books, TV, music, or videos. They are all journal or letter writers that when they went into the computer of the boy that I've referred to in Maryland, well, actually both of the kids, the kid I did the forensic evaluation, he had a well-written journal on what he was planning on doing. The averted incident where we went into the boy who had downloaded the video onto the computer, he also had journals. Eric Harris's journals went back well over a year. The journal is some type of a historical document. Also, a lot of people ask, why do they communicate intent beforehand? And most specifically, people wonder, is this a cry for help? I'm less inclined to think that than that this is part of the exhilaration. It's part of the hunt. This is predatory behavior. They're stalking, they're on the prowl, and these are kids who feel powerless, and they become empowered. But they've made the decision, they're going to do it, and they start talking about it, and I think that that adrenalizes them. These verbal expressions of intent to kill or commit suicide or do something highly dramatic within the near future, when made in the context of the other profile variables, in my opinion, it's highly predictive of an imminent attack. If a kid like this has access to firearms and starts talking about it, they're going to do it. It is almost certain they will do it. And in my opinion, this should prompt intervention. Here's some examples. These are actual samples from what kids that we looked at. Tomorrow's the big day. Something big is going to happen. Stay away from the cafeteria. One of the boys at Jonesboro said, I'm going to get her and I plan to kill the others too. He said that the day before the actual shooting. This is a letter that we got. I just want to call your attention to the reference to Jonesboro and Paducah. And then further down, the boy says, you know that feeling when you've been shit on for so long and you're made to bleed and you are so angry, and then you come across your daddy's revolver and two boxes of ammunition and you want to take it to school for some fun, illustrating both the media influence and the access to firearms at home. And lastly, we have on the right a bad environment. We're at 15, this boy is wayward. At 21, you have vice and degeneracy. On the other hand, with a proper environment, you have a teenager who's ambitious and studies hard and graduates with honors. And lastly, the product of the bad environment ends up as a psychologist. And the fellow on the left is a police officer or FBI agent or something like that. Okay, thank you very much.
I am very, very glad and very grateful to introduce Paul Moniz. Paul is an attorney and an author. He wrote a book many of you have probably read called When a Child Kills. If you haven't read it, it's a seminal work in that field. And he is presently in private practice, and you will consider it a big surprise that there are attorneys in private practice who actually go around the country and do constructive and good things for other people. And it puts you in the minority in your field. But what he has done time and again is be involved in aiding kids who have been victimized by their childhood experience and ultimately given it back to society. Some of them have given it back to society tenfold. He's worked on a lot of prominent cases. I met him while working together with him and with Scott Gordon on the Simpson case, both the criminal case and then on the successful civil case. And he works nationwide as a trial attorney and also as an expert consultant on teen homicides. And he is certainly the nation's leading expert on children who kill their parents. And likely because of the number that we have as compared to the rest of the world, he is likely the world's leading expert on that subject. And I am really grateful that you got on a plane and flew down here. I know it's not easy. You don't have your own private plane, I understand. So I want to welcome Paul Moniz. Thank you very much.
I was waiting for a time to tell this story about pre-incident indicators. I was standing outside my house around 4 years ago, and I have a little boy, he was about 7 at that time, and he was having a sword fight with his buddies. They had these plastic swords, and there were two kids in the neighborhood who had been kind of tough on him, but, you know, I let it go. They were a little older than him, and they would beat him at basketball and make fun if he couldn't get the shots. But he got the better of him. One of these kids tripped when he fell backwards, and I'm watching this happening. He takes the sword and he sticks it into the kid's throat, this plastic sword. And the kid says, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? You going to kill me? And my son says, no, I'm going to put you to the test. And the kid says, the test, yeah? My son says, yes, spell nutrition. My son, using his superior intellect, knew they couldn't spell nutrition and knew that he had won the battle. I knew there'd be a forum for that story. My work around the country for the last 15 years has been really working with the type of kids that, on a certain level, visit the worst nightmares on society because they kill the people who bring them into this world. They kill their parents. I have, in addition to that, worked on school shooting cases, homicides of varieties where kids kill their sexual predators, people who've molested them. And over the years, I've gained some small understandings, which I'd like to share with some of you today, because I am now involved around the country with some of what I consider the wash of the school shootings, which to me, unfortunately, for those of you who are in law enforcement and in education, which are, I guess, the majority of people represented here, becoming your problem. Because as we know, homicide involving teenagers and young people is still a very, very, very rare event. As my friend Scott Gordon said, though, it has tremendous consequences. In the United States, of all the teen homicides, only 1% occur in the schools, even considering the school shootings over the last year. And when we still look at the place where most kids are injured, and if we look at the FBI Uniform Crime Report, where most children are injured and or receive substantial bodily injury or death, that is visited upon them not by their friends and peers, but by their parents and by their caretakers. There are 2,500 children a year under the age of 5 who are killed by their parents every year. Now, with children, it's a sacrosanct group. We expect innocence of them. We expect goodness of them. We expect them to act in ways that we hope we would have acted when we were kids, but we knew nobody ever did. And when you look at that reality and the fact that when other people do what kids do, we don't say it's a problem with kids. And that's one of the things that's happening today. For instance, when we look at the problem of 2.2 million child abuse injuries every year, that's a substantial number. We don't say, though, that adults have a problem. All adults have a problem being child abusers. We don't give warnings to parents that, you know, to kids, you know, you have to watch out for your parents hitting you. But we do now paint with a very broad brush a number of kids. And as a result, now I think what's happening is that a lot of schools and a lot of law enforcement agencies are going to be deluged. In fact, I think we've just seen the beginning. I think what's going to happen in the fall is that after educators come back, hopefully, they will do what they didn't do in Littleton, and they will read some of the reports that were given to them by the government in terms of what they should do in spotting kids who are potentially problems. But what will happen is there'll be a deluge. And when the deluge happens, unfortunately, it's going to perhaps be worse because some of the bad cases will go underground. Kids know if somebody's going to be looking at them. Kids know not to talk, and the problem is very few of us know how to talk to kids. Gavin is exactly right. In around 80% of the homicides I work on, these kids have told people they're going to kill. In around 30%, they've told law enforcement officers in pre-incident interviews for other delinquency behaviors, things that should have clued somebody in that something was wrong with this kid and demand further investigation. So one of the things I'll be talking about a little bit is how to talk to kids, because that's a real important issue. The doctor put up some extremely important pre-incident indicators up here. But many of those things are going to come from self-reports of the kid. Their friends may know some of those things, but kids will talk to you, but unless you know how to talk to them, that information won't come out. In the last month, for example, I got a call from a school. And I told them, you know, you really don't want me. I'm, you know, the last person you want to be calling for advice unless you really think you have a problem. That was the first thing I said to them. They said, well, we're concerned about some behaviors. of a kid in the school district. And I said, well, how old's the kid? They said 4 and 5. Okay, and this is was happening at a preschool. 2 5-year-old kids were playing, and I was telling Scott Gordon this a little earlier because I think it's important for us to focus on the behavior of young kids. 2 5-year-old kids were playing in the beginning of the year a game where they were taking a girl and they were taking a rope that was in the classroom, tying her hands, and then making a noose around her neck and just leading her around. The teacher saw it and said, stop. Well, the kids continued to do this, and in fact, when the teacher took the rope away, the kids just took their fingers, and the girl, thinking it's a big game, compliantly went along with the game. Well, things got a little bit more serious, because when the teacher told them to stop playing the game, when her back was turned, they started playing the game again. When she came over and started talking to them, they started saying, oh, we don't know anything. We're not playing that game anymore. And they looked at each other, are you playing this game? No, we're not playing this game. Well, the problem got a little bit worse, because when they went to art class, one of the kids started drawing nooses. Now, the question was, should they be concerned? Well, they're 4 and 5 years old. And the problem with young kids and violence is that the line between fantasy and reality can be jumped by an accident, it could be jumped by mental illness, and it could be jumped by pure, what we consider, premeditated intent. I would submit to you that the number of kids who kill in the age range, and I've had cases as young as 8-year-olds who have committed homicides, that as the age group gets older, one would think that the issue of premeditated intent would get clearer. However, for many kids who kill, the line between fantasy and revenge is something that is very blurry, and that's the problem with these cases, is that many kids act out fantasies as part of normal play. Some kids act out, such as some of these kids who commit homicide, there are psychiatrists who will tell you that revenge fantasies are actually healthy for kids. And in fact, numerous kids have revenge fantasies. In writing, when I wrote When a Child Kills, and I was asking people, how many people when they were 11, 12, or 13, 14 years old, thought it's some transient thought that they wanted their parents dead? Not that they're gonna take a gun and kill their parents, but I wish my parents weren't here. I hate you, I wish you were dead. That's a fairly common phenomenon of adolescence, because children are prone to impulsivity. And they will say things and do things that we as adults regard as stupid, but we all know to be, as part of some of us call, the infirmities of youth. And as kids develop, and as the good doctor told us earlier, when they get to be older, 25, what happens is we start realizing the fix between reality and fantasy becomes much closer, and we can distinguish in our lives when we're fantasizing, when we can take a revenge fantasy. We can think that we really get pissed off at the guy who cuts us off, perhaps, but nope, what you're, most of us will not go after that person with our car. But for young children, the problem that we face is that they don't sometimes know the difference between the fantasy and the reality, even as they're acting it out. And that's because when young people commit offenses, they tend to do so in groups. And one way to understand what happens with young people is to look at, and I think it's extremely important, is to look at other risk-taking behaviors. When kids die in car accidents and wrap their cars around oak tree on prom night, they're rarely by themselves, they're always with friends. When you have alcohol intoxication, which produces death, where kids are chugging a gallon of vodka, they don't do it by themselves, they do it in groups. When kids commit, one of the markers that separates kids who commit felony murder, that is when they commit armed robbery or kidnapping or rape in conjunction with murder, what separates them from adults is that they tend to do it much more so in groups. I would recommend a book to you, for those of you interested in juvenile homicide, aside from When a Child Kills, which my publisher had the wisdom of discontinuing the publication last year. It will be published again later this fall. But there's an academic book that I would suggest to you called Juvenile Homicide. And it's by two of the leading homicide researchers in the country. One is Dr. Dewey Cornell, and I can provide some of these names to you later. And the other one is Dr. Elizabeth Elissa, E-L-I-S-S-A, Benedict, B-E-N-E-D-K. And they did perhaps the largest study of kids who kill. And they broke down kids who kill into two categories, basically. Kids who kill strangers and in conjunction typically with another felony, and kids who kill people that they know. And it's very interesting if you look at the differences between kids who kill in relationship with felony, who have kill in conjunction with armed robberies or rapes, and kids who kill in the other category. In the first category, you will find that those kids have a long history of acting out that you can pretty much pinpoint back to about the first or second grade. They're kids who are troublemakers in school. They're kids who do bump and grab lunch robberies, things that never get reported. Kids who will stand over another kid and make them give him his lunch or lunch money. And it graduates, and they get involved in perhaps B&Es when they're 13 or 14 years old. And then when they get to be 16 or 17 years old, the homicide becomes what some people would call a progression of this other antisocial activity. One of the main markers, though, of kids who kill in conjunction, who kill people that they know, they kill their parents, they kill their friends, or they kill their schoolmates, and this has been true for at least as long as we've been looking at this issue for around 35 years, is they don't have a history of delinquency. If anything, they have maybe some history of potential property-related crime, vandalism, graffiti, but nothing that would tell you that they follow as the sort of what we as society want to see as logical markers. And one of the problems is we've been looking at this population of kids who have killed in the school scenario as being fitting the mold of the kids who kill in this other scenario, and they're just not the same. I'm going to confine my remarks today to the kids who, of course, kill people that they know. One of the things that we know about, that I have known from interviewing over and representing over 300 kids who've committed homicide, is that in order to kill somebody, and Gavin talked about this, and it's true, in order to kill somebody, you really have to work yourself up for it. And one of the ways you work yourself up for it is to fantasize about it. But the other thing that I found when I talked to kids, and the fantasy sometimes go up to 6 months or a year prior to the homicide, just thinking about killing. The other one is talking about it. I think between what you heard earlier in terms of what people think about talking about the fantasy, how that's taken, I take when kids talk about the fantasy as really being a way for them to get up the nerve to do it, but also to try to make the skip between what they're thinking about and the reality one. Because it's a very interesting thing when I've spoken to kids I've asked them, well, how come you killed so-and-so in 1994, how come you didn't do it in 1993? And people at that time try to talk me out of it. One thing you will find with kids is that you can talk kids out of things by bursting their fantasy. Now, it depends how far along we are with the fantasy, but many kids are willing to talk, and they're willing to talk because they want to see people's reaction. If they get sloughed off, that's exactly what they want, because they're not taking you seriously. I can't tell you the number of cases of kids I've represented who've said, they didn't take me seriously, they didn't think I was serious, I was going to show them I was serious. And that gets to the notion I'd like to spend a few minutes on, which is the interview process. I think what we lack, unfortunately, and this is really a task to go forward from here, is that most psychologists who are brought into situations are very unfamiliar, and guidance counselors are very unfamiliar in dealing with kids who have violent fantasies, or kids who have committed violence. The problem is those kids have a different kind of lexicon, a different kind of way of perceiving the world, and unless you have experience in talking with those kinds of kids and in their language and developing a dictionary of validity with them to find out when they're giving you a line of bullshit and when they're telling you the truth. And unfortunately, I've also found that law enforcement officers, unless they are trained in child abuse interview techniques, don't really know. So when they assign, what's very interesting is when you assign somebody from the homicide division typically to interview
a kid who is a witness to a homicide, or a kid who is, maybe you hear a word that this kid's going to commit a homicide, you really would be well served in taking along somebody from your child interview task force. Because those are the people that are doing it day in and day out. Because if you've been dealing with adult criminals your whole life, all of a sudden to start talking to a 13, 14, and 15-year-old kid is a very different task. Because they won't give you the information right away. Of course they're going to clam up because you're an authority figure. But there are ways of getting to these kids, of engaging these kids, and the people who are your resource for this will tend to be people who have interviewed children who've been traumatized. Because traumatized kids represent the body of history of kids who have a history of violence in their backgrounds, who actually are a perfect environment in which to train your, in which skills are learned about how to interview violent kids who commit violence. So child abuse victims are visitors of, they have violence visited upon them. But they have a very similar affect, a very similar way of behavior as kids who kill. In fact, it's not any accident, for instance, that we know that one of the other major risk markers of kids who commit homicide is that they come from homes where they witness domestic violence or they are victims of it. I actually don't believe that in many of the cases where we say kids come from good homes, do we really know that they come from good homes? For instance, in many of the cases that we have seen so far that have been school shootings, those have been settled by plea bargain. There have been no intensive forensic investigations in these cases, and the conclusions that we can draw from them have to be very, very guarded unless they're going to be subject to clinical forensic investigation by people who know what they're doing. Because when you do that, you find that, especially in middle-class homes, you don't have to, it's not the physical violence, but it's really the psychological violence. And when you speak to kids who have been abused, the thing that you know about them is that it's not, they could keep the physical punishment rolls off their back. They learn how, it's not that difficult to take physical punishment once it's been visited upon you for months and months and years and years. What is difficult and lives with you your whole life becomes the psychological abuse of not only being having the physical abuse but witnessing psychological violence in your life, because then what happens is violence becomes a problem solver for these kids. And so what you find that kids who are victims of violence and kids who perpetrate violence have in common is they suffer from two very, very similar, one we call them mental disorders, and those basically are, one is post-traumatic stress disorder, and the other one typically is some long-term depression. With post-traumatic stress, in many of these kids' lives, you will find that they are impulsive because they have been trained to be hypervigilant. We heard that word earlier. They've been growing up, and it may not be that they have been in the midst of a violent episode in the days or weeks prior to the homicides, but they have been trained in preventing violence in their lives, and because of the neurobiology of violence, these kids have become protective of their environment. When you look at, there was a study recently done of what we consider the most extreme violence, kids in gangs who commit drive-by shootings. But if you look at the basis, the kids in the drive-by shooting cases, one thing that you'll find is that families that those kids come from tend to be hyper-violent families. The kids who do the shooting, in fact, gang members do separate themselves out from kids in the gangs who commit real acts of significant violence and those who don't by typically what kind of learning, grounding and learning environment they had in their homes. When you look at the kids who commit homicide in the family context or in the school context, the other thing you see is a certain kind of depression. It's my opinion that depression among adolescents is actually one of the most unrecognized mental illnesses in our country. And when you speak to kids who have committed homicide, what they'll tell you is they have what's called a tunneling affect. They start just seeing, they see no options, and the options that they see collapse around them. Why'd you have to pick the gun up and take it to school? Was it, you could have just left it at home that day, couldn't you? No, I felt There was nothing else I can do. Well, why don't you go complain to the teacher that this kid was harassing you? Well, I felt I had complained in the past and there was nothing I can do. The lack of options leads them to being enraged. And it's this rage that is taken out in these school shooting cases. I believe that suicide actually plays a much greater role in these cases than we think, because most of these kids have thought about killing themselves prior to killing other people. I would say in a good 75% of the murder cases I've been involved with, kids will talk about, first of all, there's a period when you get the gun. It's not typically you get the gun and you go out and shoot. You have to become familiar with the piece. And people become familiar with it because they have to drop that fear that they actually have of a gun. And they hold the gun, they sleep with the gun, and they actually play Russian roulette. They'll try shooting the gun with no bullets in it. They'll make it familiar to them, because when it's familiar to them, it's much easier to use. And the suicide that many of these kids feel, to me, makes them much, much more dangerous than actually kids who are not suicidal and are more in the category of the first category I talked about, of kids who commit armed robbery and then they commit violence. Because people who view themselves as having no future, people who view themselves as having nothing left to live for, there's a great book called Soul Murder by a man named Dr. Albert Schengold, and he talks about how childhood experiences for kids ranging from child abuse, and I think we have to look at what happens to kids who are harassed, what happens to kids who are pushed around a school as a form of what I would consider institutional abuse. Their models of what happens to these kids is exactly what happens to child abuse victims. The problem is that in these kinds of circumstances, it goes completely unchecked in most schools, and in fact, I believe it's condoned. Because when you don't do something for kids who are harassed like that, you're basically condoning it. And where there's condemnation of that kind of behavior, that creates a much more powerless situation. And from powerlessness grows the ability to want to gain power artificially, i.e. a handgun, the great equalizer, as we heard earlier. And so that's why when you, if you look at cases of battered women who kill their spouses, or the cases I have of kids who kill their parents, one of the things that is a jump off point is that when somebody tries to intervene on their behalf, they do so unsuccessfully. Police come to the scene and they say, okay, you don't want to, I don't see any obvious bruises or injuries to you, we're going to leave. A social worker interviews the kid in front of the kid's father to ask the kid if he's being abused. And social workers, and the kid says everything is fine. And so in the school environment, just appreciate it, I'm sure you all can, because we were all there in some way, as we discussed earlier, that these kids think it's okay, that these kids have the permission, the victims know that the perpetrators have the permission. And I really think that one of the things that was somewhat discussed at a Littleton shooting, but I think we need to learn from at least, is that no one can blame the athletes or whoever these people were that allegedly made fun of these two boys, because they had their own problems. But if we just take that one scenario and transfer it to your own school, your own jurisdiction, know that the rage that's produced in many of these kids is something that is against the school environment, because it's the school that's allowed it. One of the reasons the school, they do these shootings at schools, I'm sure from my interviews doing in some of these cases, is that they also blame the revenge is against the school as well, because the school has allowed it to happen. And it's not to say that it's not understandable, because it's a form of behavior that we've known for years has been okay. I actually believe, however, even if we got rid of all the harassment from many of these kids, we'd still have a number of these homicides. Because the intrapsychic fantasies that many of these kids have, because and this mental health baggage that they bring into high school, has been fomenting in their lives for years. even though, as I said earlier, in the school, the differences between these two homicide groups, the kids who kill in connection with armed robbery or et cetera, felony murder, and those who don't, these kids who still kill people that they know have, when you have skilled forensic evaluation and interviewing, they have problems that can be traced back to about the same age, about 8 or 9 years old. The problem is we don't really look at that, and that comes to one of my big recommendations, which is fairly controversial, but I think it's important at least to bring up in this context. At the turn of the century, we knew that certain diseases, smallpox, et cetera, were devastating the populations, and we had this notion that there should be a public health policy, and one of the best ways to increase the public health, make us healthier, is to start in the schools. And that's why we started having, you needed to have inoculations before you went to school, because the school is a place where physical disease could spread. I think we have come now to the turn of the century, and we should realize that mental health is also a collective disease that many kids have in the long term. And we need to start early on in the grade schools having some screening. Most parents will not want their kids screened for mental health. They'll say, I don't want my kid screened, my kid is fine. But the problem is that we know that we now have a suicide rate among adolescents, which to me is more important than almost the homicide rate, that is 6 times what it was in 1965. Not coincidentally, the suicide rate is up for women, up for girls and up for boys, and the predominant weapon used in suicide is guns, but still the suicide rate is very high. And in suicides, if you look forensically at suicides, you know that those kids have some of the same markers, risk markers, as kids who commit homicide. That they have been, for a period of 3 or 4 or 5 years, in subtle ways telling people, something's wrong, I need help, or maybe not even I need help, something's wrong, and there is either atypical behavior in school, there is writing behavior, there's things that they give hints to that are not acted upon. In the case of kids who write, I also find that kids will write about their fantasies, and that's something that we know today we need to take seriously. There's no doubt in my mind that if you get to the step of a kid who is both mentioning abuse, mentioning hurting people, or mentioning hurting him or herself, and then writing about it, bells and whistles, of course, now should be going off. And the reason they should be going off is because it's what psychologists and psychiatrists tell us is that's another way that they're internalizing the behavior. The first step is talking about it. The second step is writing about it, or creating, in the case of these two young 5-year-old boys, they started going to art class and then started making clay figures, and they just were letting it go. The teachers, well, they just figured, well, it's better than doing clay figures than doing the real thing. And the problem that attends to those situations is that as the kids start doing more of these behaviors, more of these exemplary behaviors of talking about it, writing about it, doing art projects about it, it increases the likelihood of the action being followed up later on. Having said that, one of the problems is, and again, I guess today's a day to offer problems as well as solutions and just make you think, and I know later on we'll be having some sessions we'll be given problems, is that the majority of kids who write about their fantasies, of course, don't act them out. 99% of them don't act them out. So the task is, again, getting back to the interview, how do you know if the kid is going to be acting them out? And so one of the things that's very important when adolescents are spoken to, and I would include adolescents going down in this kind of case, we've been focusing on the 16-year-old group because that's where it clusters for these homicides. In fact, 16 is also where homicides, if you look at the FBI statistics, it starts off at 11 years old, starts going up and up for homicide perpetration to 16 or 17. At 16 and 17, it starts wobbling, And then at 19, it starts going up more precipitously. So 16 starts reaching its at least initial plateau. And when you look at kids who are killing, however, we have to include younger populations, at least for the potential for violence. And one of the things that you really want to look for are the things that are not obvious. Kids who say, who don't respond to you, kids who have very little affect, kids who don't look you in the eye. And in fact, the first session may be a complete wash, and you say, well, the kid didn't really tell me too much, and I'm not really that concerned. Well, the problem is that you need to develop rapport and trust with children. One would think that kids would have a self-interest in having them being helped, that getting help for themselves, but we know that's not true. That's why we have mandatory child abuse reporting laws. Kids don't have a self-interest in their own survival as we would intuitively think that they should. Of course, for certain issues of maybe not getting their hand burned the first time, maybe kids will know not to put their hand back on the burner. But survival for kids and the line between their mental fix on their survival and what they can do about it is a very nebulous one. And so kids may not know that they need help. In fact, they logically won't know. And that's why some of the good indicators, at least for some of these kids, are talking to their friends. I guarantee you, if you have a problem with a kid in your school, one of the best things to do is to speak to their friends, because the chances of them, the kid himself speaking to you, probably is going not be that great the first time around. But friends, of course, will be able to give you information. I think that family members, it's going to be more difficult because, as we said, hinted earlier, some family members have blinders on. But again, I think it's a family-centered issue, and you have to be able to bring family members in, and that's an issue of letting parents know their responsibilities in the school, to the school district and to their fellow parents at school. That parents need to be involved when there is a question of a kid's behavior. In this case, I was brought in with these 2 5-year-olds. The school was very reluctant to bring the parents in because they thought that there were confidentiality issues. They didn't want one parent to know what another kid's behavior was. However, when it got to the point where one of the children had made up a noose and then was playing with the noose around a clay figure, they knew something was wrong. And that's when action took place. And not that that kid was going to kill anybody, but that kid perhaps could injure himself. That kid, by accident, could hurt somebody else. Because kids do hurt each other by accident. Now, one of the other things that I've learned is that when you look at academic records of kids, well, not in all the cases, but in a majority of the cases, you will find that in the weeks and usually the weeks and months prior to the homicide, you will find a significant decrease in grades and or attendance. And in fact, when I have my homicide cases, what I typically want to do is analyze, and I typically do analyze the attendance, and you analyze the grades, and not just the grades in the report card, because those aren't really very useful if the report card was 3 months earlier. Really, what are the grades from the teachers? And you will find that one of the first things to go, some of these kids are actually very good students, and one of the first things to go is their interest in school because of my opinion is mostly because of their depression. While I know some of these kids might suffer from a conduct disorder, the kinds of things we much more see is that they lose interest in something that they like. And typically, these kids, you will find, not in all the cases, majority of the cases, one of the few places they have success is in the academic environment. And when you start giving up in the area that you have success on, that's because you have this tunneling affect. That's because of the collapse around you. I had a homicide case recently where a boy was a straight-A student. The teachers had called him in because his grades dropped to C+ and D. He said nothing was wrong, there were just some problems at home that he was going to work them out. And he was 17 years old, and the teachers wanted to know what it was. And he said, well, just things are a little rough at home, but they'll be worked out. And he was so smart, cognitively working so well, that they believed him, that things were working out. Well, his parents were going through a divorce, a fairly violent divorce. If anybody would have checked, they would have known the father had been arrested the week before for beating up the mother during a custody dispute over the six-year-old brother. And this kid, unfortunately, 2 weeks later, when he came into school, some kid said something to him in the lunch line about moving ahead, and the kid turned around and stabbed the kid behind him 16 times with a fork. Did not kill him, stabbed him though. And the question was there any way that we could have known this boy was going to stab this kid? And at that point, nobody was, it wasn't a matter of blame, but it was a matter of, well, should anything have been done past just this primary interview for this 17-year-old kid? Should a guidance counselor have been called in? Should that teacher have referred up the line because they saw a precipitous drop in grades? And the answer is probably yes, that would have been a very good idea, because the teacher herself and himself, there were two of them, actually had a very good relationship with this boy, and they felt they could trust him. That's why a new pair of eyes was needed to come in. So again, one of the problems that one of the indicators of a drop in grades is actually pretty good, and bringing kids in to talk to them about why their grades are dropping, and perhaps having somebody do it who's not the teacher of the student, is probably a pretty good idea, because we are just talking about prevention here. The other thing that we have to look at is what happens when you have a kid who does cause problems in school, and what's the relationship between what you do to him and what he will do in the future? And let me focus on expulsion. As far as I'm concerned, expelling a kid who's committed an act of violence in school is merely just asking for when do we write the arrest warrant. Because expelling a kid who has trouble in school is releasing him or her into an environment, if there's no alternative school program, where they will just seethe. To me, it seems like it's a natural consequence of expelling somebody who's alleged to have committed violence, or who has committed violence or brought a gun to school, is to focus on that kid and is to say, okay, let's take him out of the school environment, but we need to keep track of that kid. Unfortunately, that's not the policy now, and in fact, under the Gun-Free Schools Act of 1994 and some of the new proposals that are being made now, expulsion is going to be a policy with that, and there's some debate as to whether or not there's going to be further requirements that will be funded, at least, to provide alternative placement for some of these kids. Because expelling kids or suspending kids is a real way to push them out and not to give them any kind of social interaction that at least can be observed or controlled. One of the other dangers of expelling kids from school is that it allows them to associate with other kids who are expelled or other kids not going to school. As educators, you all out there, you all know that much better than I do. But one of the things that you see in terms of the devolution and destruction of a kid's behavior is that they may have bad behavior before they're expelled or suspended. But once the suspension, or let's say the expulsion, occurs, the contacts with law enforcement significantly increase. All the studies show that. And the question is whether or not these kids who are expelled also present a potential danger of coming back to the school, or kids who are suspended present that potential danger. And I think they clearly do, and that's why there has to be a monitoring of these kids. If a kid is chosen to be expelled, I think that it would be a natural community process to let law enforcement know that somebody's been expelled, that these kids are out there with no support system, and unless they're very, very lucky, they're going to be getting into some significant trouble. In the last few minutes, I'd like just to talk about what are some of the other specific things that we can look at. In the 1970s, as we remember, prior to actually 1971, there was no airport security to speak of. And in 1971, after actually the bombings in the Mideast, in the bombing of the TWA airline, we started having much more security in airports. Now, no longer can we utter violent words in an airport. And the question is do we translate that to the school environment? Will schools become like airports? That is to say, if you utter a violent word or make an utterance of violence or an utterance of a threat, should that be grounds to take action? And should that be grounds to take some disciplinary action? I think at least for the next 6 months, because of the potential danger of copycat cases, and also because of the potential for people not really, people being confused and I think a little scared when they come back in September, that it's probably a good idea to have a filtering device for kids who are making threats in school, and that to not have, and that the, one of the few ways to ensure that you get the threats and you get the kids who are talking about it is to have an anonymous number. Kids will not report if they know that they're going to be their name is going to be taken down. Child abuse reporting would never work if people's names were taken down. And one of the things that will tend to work is to have anonymous reporting, that kids can call a number where they can report behavior that they feel or that they observe to be threats of violence. And at the same time, it seems that we need to look at what are you going to do if you bring these kids in. I think there needs to be interview protocols and investigation protocols, which is a tremendous job if you're going to take on the responsibility of knowing when do you call law enforcement. Because from the number of threats that could occur at a school on an average day, we know now that most administrators in schools, after the recent spate of school shootings, are going to be very reluctant not to want to report and not to get, not right from the jump, to get a law enforcement in on the interview. But that's just not reality. I think it's important to keep in mind when we look at this problem that for many of our kids, the violence that they witness at school will stay with them for years and years and years. And the victims that we will see for generations will be the kids who are worrying about being injured, the kids who hear about other kids being injured and view themselves as potential victims. And that really becomes the task for all of us, I think, to be very judicious in deciding which kids we're going to target for investigation, which kids, when we target them, to be clear and concise in our goal, to go in with a specified protocol of what we're going to ask them, and to really know what our plan is going to be on the other side, because we owe it to all these kids, I think, in the long run, to do it for them and for their friends and brothers and sisters to come. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Paul, very much. I'm very glad to introduce you to Gregory Gibson. His 18-year-old son, Galen, was shot and killed by a fellow student on December 14th of 1992 at Simon's Rock College. And Gregory Gibson's book, which is called Gone Boy, A Walkabout, that's the name of the book, is coming out maybe 2 or 3 months, and it is maybe October. And it is something I was lucky enough to be able to read ahead of time. Books are intended to move you in some direction. This one moved me a lot. The things I cried about in your book, Gregory, are not the things you might expect. They're not the things about your loss. They're not the things about your experience. But what really touched me is the degree of your forgiveness. And for you to experience what you did and be able to share something as uplifting as Gone Boy has become is really something, and something I strongly recommend to everyone. It was the search for truth in his son's murder. And that truth, as we know from our talks today and from the rest of what we'll be talking about later this afternoon when we get to the very practical steps, that truth is complex. It is not just who pulled the trigger, and it's not just why he pulled the trigger. It is, that book is a really commanding inquiry into violence in America, into guns, into manhood in America, and ultimately though you may not have seen it as its principal product, into forgiveness and learning. And Gregory, if you come up, I thank you very much for being here.
Let's see, we had the showing the teeth, the pouch. I got to say, it's just astonishing to me. I spent about 5 years researching every aspect of this terrible thing that happened to me, and it's astonishing to me the degree to which things that people have said today have correlated to what I learned. I mean, this is real stuff. It's mind-boggling to me. I'd like to begin by thanking Gavin for the opportunity to be here today. His work has given me a new way to think about the problems of violence in our society. Speaking of a school shooting incident, De Becker said something to the effect that if school authorities had sufficient knowledge, they would have made different decisions. Thus, and I quote, "My observations are not about blame, but about education." I think you can see from the substance of my remarks what a tremendously empowering and liberating idea this can be. Not about blame, but about education would be a good description, for me at least, of what has gone on here today. Now for some facts. On the morning of December 14th, 1992, a UPS delivery was made to the campus of Simon's Rock College, a small undergraduate institution for students of exceptional academic ability. Nestled in the hills of western Massachusetts, presided over by a cadre of dedicated academicians, it didn't seem there could be a safer place in the world. One package in this delivery caught the eye of the lady who ran the college mailing room. It was large, over 3 feet tall, and heavily weighted at one end. It was addressed to a student named Wayne Lowe. The return address was clearly labeled Classic Arms. She showed this parcel to several staff members who were on their way to a morning administrative meeting. They brought the package to the meeting, where eventually it was discussed. Several staff members were vehemently against letting Wayne Lowe take possession of the package. Some thought it should be opened and examined on the spot. Some thought Wayne Lowe should be made to open it under supervision. The dean of the college, Bernard Rogers, considered it an invasion of privacy to open the student's package without consent. He was concerned about school policy on privacy issues and about the legal implications of opening another person's mail. He decided to return the package to the mailroom and told Wayne Lowe's dorm supervisor to find out what the package contained. However, and here's the first key failure in the string of failures that's common to such tragedies, this normally efficient administrator did not spell out to the dorm supervisor exactly how to accomplish this. As it turned out, the package contained, among other things, 200 rounds of live ammunition. In fact, it was just an accident that the dorm supervisor saw the package at all. Wayne Lowe, who had been eagerly awaiting its delivery, picked it up as soon as it was returned to the mailroom. Someone saw him taking it back to his dorm and informed the supervisor, who hurried after him. She arrived at his door as he was opening it. He refused to let her into the room, citing a college rule that said two administrators had to be present for a room search. To make a long story short, she went back, called the dean. The dean said, "Go look and see what's in the package, but don't search the room." She comes back with her husband, who's also a dorm supervisor. There are now the requisite two people for a dorm search, but because of school policy, they don't search the room. They just examine the contents of the package that Wayne Lowe has spread out for her inspection. Of course, he's hidden the bullets. By continued chance, Wayne Lowe had previously scheduled a meeting with Dean Rogers to discuss another matter. At this meeting later in the morning, the contents of the package were brought up by the dean. Regarding his meeting with Lowe, the dean later said, quote, and this is wonderful because you hear it again and again, "He was calm, coherent, logical, and open. There was nothing in his demeanor to indicate that he was a dangerous person or lying to us." Wayne told the dean that the package contained gun parts that were presents for his father for Christmas and for himself. Wayne then took a taxi to a nearby town where he purchased a 7.62 millimeter Chinese type 56 carbine, commonly known as an SKS. His purchase complied with state and federal laws in every respect. In fact, he did not violate a law until he stepped back onto a college campus with his gun hidden in a guitar case. He went back to his room, took a test, ate dinner. At the evening meal, he was acting so strangely that one of his friends realized he posed a threat. Between 8 and 9 p.m., this boy called campus security, but got only an answering machine. He then called the dorm supervisor, the same lady who had seen the package, told her that Wayne had a gun, was planning to use it, that she was on his list, and that this would happen, quote, tomorrow. Terrified, the dorm supervisor called Dean Rogers. He phoned the provost, a man named Ba Nguyen, who evacuated the supervisor and her family from the dorm. As it happened, there was a dorm meeting going on just then at which Wayne Lowe was present. He returned to his room just a few doors down from the dorm supervisor's apartment. At this point, Ba Nguyen instructed the dorm supervisor's husband to go to Wayne Lowe's room. He refused. And Ba Nguyen himself decided not to go to the boy's room alone and continued with his evacuation. Once the family was safely evacuated, Ba Nguyen began forming a plan to apprehend Wayne Lowe. Dean Rogers was still assessing the validity of the phone call, working on a way to deal with the threat that Wayne might pose. While these people were struggling with their plans, Wayne had plans of his own. His 200 rounds loaded into 30-round ammo clips, he proceeded to the front guard shack and communications center, where he shot the watch lady repeatedly at close range. A car driven by a faculty member stopped at the guardhouse, and Wayne shot through the window of the car, murdering the teacher. He then proceeded to the library, where he murdered my son and wounded another boy, then walked across the campus, quote, shooting at anything that moved, wounding two more boys. When he got to the student union, he called police and negotiated his surrender. Now, there's an enormous irony to this horrific sequence, as if the events themselves weren't bad enough. Wayne's gun was cheap and shoddily manufactured. The aftermarket accessories, specifically the 30-round ammo clips, were also cheaply made. Because of an imperfect fit between gun and clip, Wayne's gun jammed repeatedly after every few shots. He'd fire a few rounds, then have to insert a new clip in order to fire a few more times. Out of the 200 bullets in that Classics Arms package, Wayne was able to fire only about 20 rounds. It is likely that he simply gave up in frustration after his gun failed to perform in the manner that he had hoped. The consequences for the college, and for us all, if he'd had a fully functional weapon, are terrible to consider. And it still blows my mind to this day. And this is, interject, everything that we've heard so far has been about, from the point of view of the students. What I'm talking to you about today, from my point of view, is about the administration, because there's something to be learned there as well, I think. The story of the college's efforts to avoid liability in this matter is a short one, though court proceedings stretched it out over many years. It was apparent to us, Galen's family, that the administrators at Simon's Rock College had made some very bad decisions on that December night in 1992. To our surprise and shock, they did not admit these mistakes to us, nor did they apologize for their actions. Instead, they denied any responsibility for what had happened and adamantly insisted they'd done the best they could under the circumstances. As a result, we sued them. We were eager for the proceedings of a civil trial to sort the matter of responsibility for this terrible episode. Wayne Lowe's murder trial was held a year after the shootings. To no one's surprise, he was found guilty on two counts of first-degree murder. The trial testimony, while only peripherally concerned with the actions of college officials, strengthened our conviction that they had mishandled the situation. Well, this is about education, not blame. Upon considering the lessons to be learned from the Simon's Rock shooting, a few very simple things become immediately apparent. These might be enumerated as basic precepts that have their origin in what was not done at Simon's Rock College. First, and most importantly, it could happen here. In 1992, it would have been hard to imagine a safer place than a library on the campus of a liberal arts college. It could happen here. Daily repetition of this unfortunate mantra would probably be sufficient to avoid complacency. Second, cultivate healthy and mutually respectful relations with community law enforcement. One of the major reasons behind Dean Rogers' reluctance to call the police was that he feared it would result in ridicule for Simon's Rock College. Police had been summoned to campus a few years before, happily, for a false alarm, and college officials felt they'd lost credibility. This simply cannot be allowed, no matter how vast the gap between town and gown. It could happen here. It could happen anywhere, with dire consequences for everyone. Cooperation should be possible, even if upon no other basis than this one shared understanding. Third, be aware of local, state, and federal laws and how they impact your situation. We were talking about this a little bit at lunch today. Law enforcement using educational statutes as a lever to intervene in some cases. Dean Rogers actually thought it was against the law to open a UPS package addressed to someone else. He was tragically wrong. And finally, have a simple and clearly stated policy with action plans that designate specific individuals. When I asked Ron Ringo what he would have done about the Wayne Lowe situation if he'd been called in, he replied, quote, simple, call the police, detain Wayne Lowe. This sort of thing doesn't take many lines in a faculty handbook. Is it overly optimistic to expect that such precepts might be instilled in the esoteric institutional culture of a place like Simon's Rock? Can we expect not blame, but education to be a viable strategy with which to confront the terribly violent propensities of contemporary American culture? I would argue that any educational institution is capable of such a transformation. And in defense of my assertion, I propose the following thought experiment. Imagine that a large, heavy package from a company named Classic Arms arrived on the campus of Simon's Rock College today. Chinese fire drill or what? Would it be retained until its intended recipient had opened it in the presence of college staff? Would this recipient be subjected to thorough questioning about his intended use of the contents? If the package contained bullets and/or gun parts, would the police be summoned? The answer to these questions is yes. Bernie Rogers and his colleagues have been educated in the matter of gun violence on school campuses. As individuals, they have a new awareness of the problem, and as members of an institution, they have a much more clearly defined policy, understanding of laws, and better relations with local police. In his 1994 deposition, Rogers stated that prior to the shootings, the training of dorm supervisors did not involve public safety issues and contacts with police. However, after December 14, 1992, quote, in the event that there is any sign of potential danger or violence on campus, they are to notify the dean of students, who is to contact the police. Though Dean Rogers and his colleagues failed in their battle to avoid legal and moral liability, the final result of even this failure has been enhanced awareness. I believe this sort of education is possible without the tragic curriculum Rogers had to undergo. I believe it offers effective and immediate answers to some of the problems of gun violence, a real and viable alternative to the seemingly endless and futile political battles over gun control that have divided our nation for years. That's all I got. Thank you.
I mentioned earlier that you would recognize Gil Garcetti from lots of high-profile cases in which, even if you're not from Southern California, you've seen him on the news. And he has always, in my experience, used his opportunities to speak publicly, which a lot of these high-profile cases give him, to do something good with the public forum. And yesterday he spent 2 hours with us in a meeting of only 8 people discussing these things, and to get the district attorney, who's got 1,100, is it 1,100 or is it 11 lawyers? Because if it's 11, I've invited the wrong guy. I want to make that clear right now. 1,100 lawyers, for him to spend that kind of time personally working on improving predictions is a really great commitment. And I remember right after he was elected, he formed the county's first ever, and I imagine probably the country's first ever, Bureau of Crime Prevention and Youth Services. And they have pioneered some pretty remarkable programs for a district attorney's office to do. My favorite one is the plan that he put together that pairs county firefighters with at-risk boys, generally 12-year-old boys. And they work with on-duty firefighters, and they are mentored by district attorney staff members. That is about as far from putting criminals away as you can imagine. But he has made it clear that he is also looking at developing relationships with young people who need not become criminals. There's another thing they started, and that one, by the way, that I just mentioned is something you can carry back to any community you're from. Firefighters will want to do it, and high schools will have no shortage of troubled kids who can benefit from that relationship. The other thing he started is the ACT program here, which is abolish chronic truancy. We're learning that truancy is an important pre-incident indicator for various forms of criminality. It's one of the earliest ones. And this program places prosecutors at schools, physically at the schools, to work with administrators and teachers and parents and students to intervene at the very start of this truancy cycle, which we know now often leads to other problems. And that program has reduced truancy in all 135 schools where it's been applied. And Gil Garcetti is, in my experience, a real friend to new ideas. I'll give you a great example. We know that in virtually all of the cases of multiple shooting at school, and in virtually all of the cases that James McGee spoke about that he would characterize as these major incidents, whether they're bombings or arsons or other things that kids do that are unusual and attention-seeking, we know that in virtually all of them, the kids threatened first. In the United States, there is one district attorney's office that has a threat assessment team, and it's Garcetti's district attorney's office. So I am proud to live in LA County, and very proud that he wanted to address this group today, and I ask you to welcome District Attorney Gil Garcetti.
Thank you, and good afternoon. I have been in the district attorney's office for 30 years. I've been the elected DA for 6.5 years, but occasionally I do venture where some of you come from, and that's into the schools. In fact, just about a month ago now, I went back to the junior high school, Colonel Middle School, where my mother graduated from in East Los Angeles, called Belvedere Junior High School. I was principal for a day. I wasn't there. You laugh, right? Well, tell me, you're probably all shaking. Good, good. He got to see what it's really like in there. And indeed, I did. One of the first things I had to do, unfortunately, was expel a kid. He brought on a razor blade on campus. And he just didn't bring it on. He brought it on, and then on a friend's shoulder, he carved the gang insignia right there on his shoulder. And the principal didn't have to give me a whole lot of guidance for that one, and he was gone, unfortunately, gone. But it was a real lesson for me, and the whole day was a real lesson. Again, a greater appreciation of what you, so many of you who are here today, educators and care for the kids, what you have to deal with every day. I mean, this is one kid out of a population of just under 3,000 kids. And the vast majority of those kids are kids who simply want to learn, want to be safe. Ordinarily, I know my subject well enough that I feel comfortable in giving somewhat of an extemporaneous speech. But I felt the importance of this speech was that I wanted to work on it because I felt every word I felt was of sufficient import. So bear with me as I deliver the speech. And it is a speech that I feel strongly and passionately about because this is a matter in which, you know, you wouldn't have come on this Saturday to be here unless you cared. You cared about the kids, you cared about your community. So let me begin by my. I want you to suppose that a criminal justice genie popped out of a bottle to grant you one wish related to crime. What would you wish? To end child abuse, to stop gang violence, juvenile crime, domestic violence. And then think a minute, what would you have wished for 20, 30 years ago, or 2 years ago? Today, we all wish to protect our children from violence. Gun violence against children is appalling. Those of you who are educators, when you studied for your degrees, you probably had no idea how much time you were going to be spending and focusing on violence. This meeting has been called to discuss ways to look at potential violence among students and assess threats in schools. I'm heartened that so many of you, in fact, gave up your Saturday to come here. I have a goal to stop violence, to be recognized as the district attorney who prevented crime as well as prosecuted crime. Some say so-called social work is not our job, but as the chief law enforcement officer of the County of Los Angeles, my job is to protect nearly 10 million people in the County of Los Angeles. Yes, putting criminals in prison, that protects people, but that's not the only answer, and long range, it's certainly not the best answer. Stopping young people from becoming violent is certainly part of the job of protecting society, and frankly, I'm in a unique position to do this. First, my office handles all juvenile crime cases, which gives us a firsthand look at behavior and family situations of violent juveniles. I also work closely with our full-time legislative advocate in Sacramento, who, with our prosecutor, constantly proposes and analyzes law to make us a bit safer. I instituted, as you heard from Gavin, a family violence division to specially handle cases of domestic violence and child abuse, which gives us more insight into stopping violence in families and the violent cycles it perpetuates. Yes, one of my first tasks as the elected district attorney was to establish the Bureau of Crime Prevention and Youth Services. You've heard about some of our programs, but one of the programs that wasn't mentioned really has hundreds of prosecutors and investigators from our office volunteering with more than 9,000 at-risk fifth graders for an entire school year. Kids learn to stay in school, they learn how to avoid gangs, and they learn how to resolve disputes without violence. By the way, our Crime Prevention Bureau started, I believe, the nation's first toll-free domestic violence hotline. It's called LA County Safe Way Out. It's been in operation for about 5 years, and almost 40,000 people have called in, victims of domestic violence, asking for immediate assistance. You should know that Gavin DeBecker funds that 800 line. So what do we make of all of this? I guess that's why we're all here today. That's why I have some staff members here today. Try and find out what we can make of all this. I mentioned that my office handles all juvenile crime cases in Los Angeles County. Most juveniles, thank goodness, are only in the system one time. But we do see young, hardcore criminals too. We've seen a few 12-year-olds, cold-blooded killers. We've seen these kids in court. We try to figure out how they got there. But rather than wait until they get to court, we want to, and I really mean this, we want to reach budding criminals before they become violent, before they leave other victims behind. And we'll support, my office will support whatever is feasible in doing this. Gavin DeBecker is proposing an advisory board to be established to test the Mosaic threat assessment programs in schools by this September. And I support this effort. I'm sure that you've heard much about Mosaic today, about its use by the Sheriff's Department in predicting domestic violence by colleges in assessing stalking threats. In a pilot program, Mosaic's Sheriff's deputies, or guided Sheriff's deputies, to question domestic violence victims at crime scenes, providing prosecutors and investigators with information they didn't previously have. Mosaic for Schools would do one thing that I think is critical. Mosaic would include evaluations by several people involved with each student assessed. Parents, school administrators, teachers, some students. We hope will honestly put out all the cards on the table to assess a threat. They will probably be looking at potentially violent students as they never have before and paint a thorough picture not previously seen. Let's hope that any code of silence will be broken when students balance the risk to a large number of their friends with protecting one student who may pose a threat. The magnitude and the horror of Littleton really drove the point home to students, I hope to all of us, just how important it is, and listen to these words, to constantly assess threats. To constantly assess threats. We have to seriously consider words and actions that might have been previously and thought of just talk or acting out or violent fantasies that would never go beyond the fantasy stage. We've learned the hard way. Perhaps the question asked by Mosaic will wake up many parents, wake them up out of a state of denial. Perhaps it can involve absent parents who didn't accept responsibility or pay attention to their troubled children. Perhaps school officials can expand their understanding, probe deeper when they participate in Mosaic, to try to understand and assess again potential threats from students. This is the value that I see in Mosaic. So getting back to our genie, I mentioned earlier, if I could ask for one wish to be granted related to crime, it might not be what you would expect from the district attorney. I would wish that magically all children were cared for from the moment of conception, for a healthy, nurturing, loving, supportive environment for every child, starting before its conception and continuing through adulthood. This from both parents and from society. Sadly, my wish isn't going to come true for a while, which is why it's crucial that we, let me emphasize that we, all of us in this room working together and people who are not here today, who work directly with children and are directly responsible for their safety, continue meaningful exchanges of information and then initiate the programs that come out of those exchanges. Talk is not enough. You've got to do something after you've talked, after you've learned. Let's apply all the scientific, sociologic, and legal means to identify and help students who are abused or abusers, who are isolated, who have the potential to be violent. In so doing, we will all be doing our jobs to protect our children from violence. That's why you're here. That's why I'm here. Thanks for your time.
We're going to have a panel now that's run by Scott Gordon, and I just want to tell you, many of you obviously already know Scott, but I want to tell those of you who don't know him, Scott Gordon is a deputy DA here in Los Angeles County. He is a founder of their STAT team, Stalking and Threat Assessment Team. He has worked in many, many environments in the district attorney's office that have to do with prediction of dangerousness. That included working with abused children, working with domestic violence, which is where he has made his mark in this county in an extraordinary way. Many of you saw Scott many times, whether you remember it or not, because he was the attorney in the O.J. Simpson case who was responsible for the domestic violence parts of the case. And he was the fellow, who'd you look like? He was the Newt Gingrich that occasionally came into the courtroom. But he then, he is also the chairman of Los Angeles County's Domestic Violence Council, which is a very large organization that gets tremendous national attention. And he has done some pretty extraordinary things. He has prosecuted war crimes in Bosnia as a representative of the United States, selected by the United Nations. He has been involved in the development of many types of predictive instruments, including some mosaic systems, and he is the person that in this room, that if you were to take no other name and phone number of someone who you can bother, who will welcome your call and help you, he is that person. Because when it comes to these topics, he is very knowledgeable and extraordinarily well-connected in this county and around the country. And so I am very glad that you were able to be here, and I ask you to welcome Scott Gordon. Thank you, Scott.
Thank you. Good afternoon. There was a study the National Institute of Justice did several years ago about adult learning and conferences. And what they determined was that late afternoon, especially on a gorgeous day, that people most want to hear from a lawyer. So I'm happy to be able to fill that for you. And I'll be reading from code sections for the next hour. We have a wonderful panel. I'm going to introduce. We're going to be going through an interesting exercise. I want to thank them for their flexibility because we're going to walk through a case. And I think the process that you're going to see here is one that a lot of agencies are, and jurisdictions are dealing with. Many, many people have found that the best way to deal with these cases is through a case management or a team kind of approach. And the process we go through in working through a case is exactly what you're going to see. This panel brings together a tremendous amount of experience and expertise. We have Sheriff Raul Ramirez, who has been part of the Marion County Sheriff's Department for the past 23 years and is now the sheriff. So having been a police officer, I will be calling him sir. He is a consultant on police community relations with the Department of Justice, works throughout Oregon, where he is the sheriff, in Washington, and is very, very knowledgeable on these instances and has dealt with many of these kind of instances as a law enforcement executive. I think what's important about him being here is one of the things we're going to talk about is that you can't intervene unless the policy holders are part of it, and he certainly is not only part of it, but I think one of the movers in his communities. Todd Rogers, lieutenant with the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department, is the director of the, what's called RCPI, which is the Regional Community Police Institute. It is a groundbreaking multidisciplinary institute that has taught and worked on solutions for preventing violence throughout California. Has held award-winning programs in Los Angeles, San Diego, San Luis Obispo. He's been with the Sheriff's Department for more than 14 years. Michelle Taylor is with Gavin and Becker Incorporated, is a director of threat assessment and management for Gavin's office. She is a national expert in stalking, helped develop Mosaic 5. And you know, you talk about partnerships and people you can call. I will tell you, as a public agency, to find private agencies that are always there to assist is a unique thing. And I call Michelle about cases all the time. And I will tell you that as long as I do this, she consistently comes up with perspectives and ways to look at cases that I hadn't thought of and has a tremendous amount of expertise. Rod Swinehart is the administrative analyst for the Oregon Judicial Department, assigned to the trial courts of Marion County in Salem, Oregon. He is the coordinator of Marion County's multi-agency threat assessment team, which is comprised of representatives from the court, school district, and the Marion County Sheriff's Office. Lieutenant Bob Malloy has been a police officer for 18 years. He currently is a lieutenant with the Boston University Police Department, where he's worked since 1987. He also holds a bachelor's from Boston University in criminal justice and urban affairs. And I think his perspective, being on the forefront of how to deal with threats from a school environment, is very, very important. A very important member of our panel, Aaron Ryle, a senior at South Salem High School in Oregon, is here to talk about students' perspectives. I want to assume we're in the city of Columbia. It's a small coastal California community, mid-size, very diverse population, ranges from lower income up to higher income, and nothing particularly remarkable about the community. Bob, you get a call. Let's assume you're working with the high school security, the police for the school district. And you get a call from one of the teachers at JFK High School. And JFK High School is a very good high school in the region. Parents are clamoring to get there. You know, they're lying about where they live to go there. It's a great school. And one of the teachers calls up because she just gave the kids an assignment. She gave their junior English class an assignment to do essays, creative writing. She left it very open. She said, I want you to write an essay about something about the school, about your high school experience. And what she got from one kid, a kid named Tim Baldwin, a 16-year-old junior at school, is an essay called Extreme Rage. And what this essay talks about is about a high school junior who is going out with a cheerleader, and the cheerleader dumps him, and it hurts him so badly he plots to get her back, and the way he's going to get her back is to shoot her at the homecoming dance. And she calls you up, the teacher, saying, you know, this kind of frightens me. I don't know what to do. What do you tell her?
The first thing I tell her is I'd like to interview him, call him into the office and talk to him about it, just see what his feelings are and try to substantiate any of the stories that came up in this essay. I would then interview him and then take a step depending on what his statements were to me.
Okay. Here, let me ask you a question. Let's assume, I mean, I think it's safe to say in a school that when the campus police are talking to a different student, not everybody kind of knows that, right? If Bob comes in one day and picks out this kid, says, Tim, come down with me, how are the other kids going to react to that?
Depends on how he is in a social group. If he's in a very popular social group, they might not pick on him. But say he's kind of an outcast, he's probably going to get a lot of flack from his peers about it.
Great, let me tell you about him, okay, and you can tell me. He was actually fairly popular, but where he got most of his popularity is he was going out with a girl named Heather, who's very popular in the school. She's a cheerleader. She's real popular. She kind of was in the center of kind of the in crowd, the popular kids. And while he was going out with her, he was in all their activities, but you know, she dumped him about 2 months ago, and since then he's been kind of by himself. And in fact, kind of taking a little flack from the group.
Well, then in that case, if he got called down to the office by the police officer, he'd probably see more flack from the students. They'd probably ask him say lots of rude comments to him, maybe spread rumors about drugs or whatever.
So what any of us do, you guys are going to know about, right? And you're going to talk about it.
Pretty much, yeah.
Okay. Oh, Bob? Not that that ever happens at home with kids. Bob, let's assume you talk to him. He presents himself as a mature kid, smart. You ask him about the essay, and what he says is, hey, it was a story. She told us to be creative. I like Stephen King books. I like some of this horror stuff, and I thought I would kind of press the edge, and it's a story.
Well, at that point, if he states that, we'd probably take another step further, maybe start interviewing some of the people in his orbit, people he hangs around with, perhaps Heather herself, try to determine what they think of him and what their feelings are. We don't want to go overboard too quickly. I mean, it was an essay, but yet we still want to try to get an idea and basically start a preliminary investigation as to what's going on with him and how real these threats are.
You can call Todd at the Sheriff's Department or the Police Department?
Yeah, I would probably contact our local police department, see if they know anything about it, see what they know about it, notify them.
Well, Todd, let me assume that you get a call from a high school in Los Angeles County, and it's a security officer or a police officer at the high school, and he says, hey, we've got this essay that we're real concerned about, and it's a fictional story about a kid that's going to kill the homecoming queen. Are you going to send a unit out there?
Well, as part of my middle management training, I'd probably delegate that to a sergeant, first of all.
I love to hear that. Now, what I learned as a patrol officer was to always have a sergeant there when you didn't know and put his name on the report.
Absolutely.
Sergeant Rogers concurs, so it goes both ways.
And I don't think you're going to let me off the hook, so I
no,
would definitely
sir.
Send one of our patrol units out there to liaison with the school, and if we had a school liaison deputy, get him or her involved as well.
Let me ask you. Sheriff Mears, let me ask you about that, because that's one of the things we talk about, because I think there's a lot of responses. I think there's some law enforcement agencies that would do that. Do you think that many of the law enforcement agencies in the United States, if a school called up and said, hey, we got an essay that we're scared about, are going to roll it black and white out there?
The majority of law enforcement does not have a school liaison officer. Typically, the majority of law enforcement agencies are small, one, two, under five man departments. So typically, if they have a school in their jurisdiction, they might not have a school liaison officer, but hopefully through the training that they would have established a liaison with the school authorities.
Let's say we're working together. Another step. Michelle, this starts to happen. So now we have word going around. We're starting to talk to kids. Tim is staying pretty quiet. But one of the parents call you, Heather's parents call you. And Heather's parents say, you know what, we're worried about this kid. One of the reasons why she broke up is he's real dark and he's moody and we really didn't like him. And we told her to break up with him. And you know what? He just called her up and said, you know, you got me in trouble with the cops and I'm really, really mad at you. And they know about this essay, so they've called you to say, what can we do?
I would then, if I were contacted by Heather's parents, focus on Heather's safety as opposed to what the rest of the group so far has been doing, which is focusing on the safety of all of the students. But I would certainly want to touch base with them to see what they've learned in their investigation.
Well, let me ask you a question. We've heard pretty active intervention so far. I mean, all of a sudden, because of this essay, we got black and white showing up. We have school security officers showing up. The kids are talking about this. Does that in any way, could that have a negative impact on her safety?
Certainly, all of that. As soon as you start imposing negative consequences on the person, you risk them getting worse and them escalating. So, as you know, being in the private sector, I would offer a slight variation from the beginning, which would be to gather that information, to go interview, to find out how much of the information in his essay was accurate. Like, is there, you know, a homecoming dance coming up? Did he have a girlfriend that he just broke up with? Interview his other teachers to try and get other pieces of the puzzle. There's a whole lot of information available out there from people other than that student. And when you do decide to interview that student, sometimes if you think that the downsides to involving law enforcement officer on campus might create some other problems, you might come up with another reason to interview him. Either you could have a teacher interview a lot of the students in the class and just say, hey, following this essay, I really learned a lot and I'm going to be meeting with each of you for 20 minutes. So you're really not singling that student out at all, but you're still getting the benefit of the interview and the information.
Ron, let's say we have people intervening. What information might you want some of these folks to get for you about this kid or about this situation?
Was the paper well-written or not?
Great question. No, it's a great question. Is it organized? Is it functional? Is it? No, it was very neatly typed. You know, word processor, actually very good. In fact, the teacher says, you know what, if not for the content, he would have got an A on this. I'm just kind of put off by the content. But she senses a lot of anger in it.
If it's really well written, it would give the teacher an excuse to speak with him about it, that compliment him on the paper. Again, she's a writing teacher. I ask about where he got the idea for the paper, whether his own life had given him some insight in it.
Let's assume we're a step forward, because the cops are here. I mean, we've got cars going, you know. Pretty soon we're probably going to have a satellite truck up here. But let's assume we got police officers in here talking about this. What do you want these police officers, because you run our threat management team, to find out? What are some of the things we want to know?
What's he like in school? How's he get along with his fellow classmates?
And let me ask you, your parents get a call from any of these folks on here. What does that do to you?
They're not going to be happy.
You think?
One thing that kind of bothers me about all this is that with the increased attention that he'd receive, he's going to have a lot of feelings himself that are going to be negative. Mm-hmm. His parents will give him some negative feelings, students. I think one thing that you may not want to do when pursuing this is to isolate him, you know, take him out of class and whatnot.
Is anything they're doing going to isolate him from your population? Their dad, the parents are coming down. You got people talking to his ex-girlfriend, his friends. Is that going to isolate him?
Well, if they came to school and talked to him, that would definitely isolate him, pulling him out of class at all. Even like a parent-teacher conference, I think, would isolate him in his own way. If he is feeling like an outcast, this is only going to intensify those feelings. It's not gonna help him in any way.
Sheriff, do we have any crime yet?
Anything at this point?
Let's say you're continuing, and Heather goes to her locker, and she opens her locker, and there's a card there and a rose, and it is an invitation to the homecoming dance in a month from him, and it says on it, if you don't go with me, you're going to die, bitch. What do you do?
And it's from him?
You think. Yeah, from the context. We're not sure. I mean, you think it is. How do we find out? What do we do? It's handwritten?
Well, that's definitely a direct threat. He would be our main suspect.
And, good. And, I mean, that's that good would, police thing we're right
we
in.
Would pull him right, we would pull him right back in. You know, obviously, we'd still be investigating this thing, but if she received another threat that would really, that would step up our concern, very much so.
Well, Sheriff, let me ask you, is that crime now, if that is him?
It's still not a crime, but that would take you to the next level of intensifying the investigation to specifically seek out whoever wrote that document.
Now, we got, let me get to that.
Okay.
Don't worry. And this is a real interesting point, and we got out, and I'm glad we got it. We have a sheriff from Oregon. Let me switch to Los Angeles. We got a crime?
We have terrorist threats and possible stalking.
Depends on your jurisdiction. You know, you've hit a great point, and you hit something that I see in cases all the time. I'll have cases that are presented as threat cases, and you heard we talked about stalking or not stalking. The difference between stalking and threats is stalking, threats one time, stalking maybe multiple. So let's say we do this investigation. Yeah.
Aaron, that's a good point, and you made two good points. One being that you don't want to isolate him, and the way that we in private practice accomplish that is we look for an excuse to talk to that person as well as all of their friends for an unrelated reason that we know will get them on that subject, that we can end up talking about that. And since we're not law enforcement personnel, it's never classified as someone in trouble. It's not isolating them as a negative stigma. We're in here to research whatever issue it is, and then we get to the information that way.
Bob, let's say we do some of the investigation, and I know you said you were continuing. What we do is when we talk to his circle of friends, and he had a small circle of four or five guys that he hung around with, what they tell you is, you know what, he had been talking about Heather a lot. And when he was with her, he talked about she was the only one for him. Never thought he would be going out with a girl like her, cheerleader, just all he talked about to the point that almost didn't want to deal with him anymore. When she dumped him, all he would talk about is her, but with different things. Talk about watch, he'd walk, follow her around to see if she's with other guys. She, in fact, she saw him going out with a guy on the football team, and you have several different incidents documented that he said, you know what, if I ever see them together again, I'm going to kill him. Do you have a different crime, do you think, maybe?
It's still a threat. I mean, he still made a threat. And it's...
Michelle, what do you think? Any different?
I think that's a great point, because once you interview Heather, you can find out if there's the pre-incident indicators and the warning signs of a domestic violence case. And what you're looking at to work with and solve and resolve a domestic violence case is much different than a multiple homicide school shooting. So you want to target down to see what kind of a problem you're dealing with.
We need to recognize this as a community problem, not just a school law enforcement problem. And there are other resources out in the community that we can take advantage of, youth alternative diversions, and maybe we can divert his attention to something else. And if that circle of friends is shrinking or non-existent, provide one.
I think definitely under all these circumstances, I'd want to call an emergency meeting with the school, the members of the teachers, parents,
hey,
and police. Before this event, and explain all the facts without you know the issue of confidentiality, keeping that.
So we're going to do almost a community meeting or a meeting of the stakeholders, right?
Right.
Who do you want there?
I'd want parents.
Which parents? All the parents.
All the parents of the attending seniors. Whoever's attending.
So open it up, not just specifically involved like Heather's parents or Tim's. You want the whole senior class there?
I would want all the parents. Yes. Okay. If you had to have it in an auditorium, I.
Who else?
School board, the police department, I'd attend, and probably limited to that.
Michelle, what do you think about doing that?
I think it's a good idea to do it maybe on a more limited basis where you're involving either a specific victim's parents or the president of the PTA, something more controllable. And if it were to the point where I thought everybody should know about it because it was that foreseeable and likely to happen, then I would say the event should be canceled, as opposed to notification.
Hey, we've hit that point, and we've kind of gone through this one. And what I'd like to do in the few minutes, if you would take a minute or two to talk about, we have 5 minutes left, so a minute each maybe, talk about as a community, if you were going to put together a team in your community that was going to work on this, who should be part of this, and what would you like to see them do? What would you like to see them do in your school, Aaron, about these issues?
Well, one thing I'd like to see is them not make too big a deal of this. This is, however, a school, and any outside involvement would be a distraction to learning. I mean, schools are there to learn. When you bring in all these people and bring patrol cars and got people talking about closing down the dance, it's a very big distraction. So I think that I would pick a council that would do it in a very discreet manner, you know, not maybe just some people that maybe the school liaison officer, the vice principal, maybe a counselor, a teacher, and you know, not get it too big because it would be a distraction.
Keep it confined, yeah.
Yeah.
Sheriff Mayor, some community strategies that just ideas to throw out.
And part of
in
that,
in general,
I would say, would we also involve the president, student body president of the school, to again validate that yes, this makes sense. And then again, I don't know to what degree the juvenile department has been involved in this process, whether there were other factors get them involved, but try to minimize it to a small group that, and also PTA representatives.
Ted Rogers. Law enforcement, education, local government, parents, students, I think all should be involved in this. We need open lines of communication and collaboration to prevent these things from happening in the first place, but beyond that, to prepare for them in the event that they do, tactically and otherwise. And I'm talking about things such as getting diagrams of schools, such as was an issue in Columbine.
All right. So pre-planning, the more if you already have a notion up front as, and I think going to your community, you're already doing these before there's any incident, you've already got a multi-disciplinary team going, right?
It's actually multi-layered. The team has representatives from school district law enforcement and the courts, but the actual case management is done by the individual agency, by the school board. Their own case management teams evaluate, and the overall team offers suggestions or input.
I'd like to see that ideally involved, set up ahead of time with people who have an interest in this. So you would have some regular people on that panel, including the school psychologist, the principal, some administrators, local law enforcement, president of a PTA. And I agree with the student representative only for very select aspects at certain points in the process. Maybe having those meetings off-site in order to minimize the distraction.
And Bob, always back to the schools where it started from, where it ends.
I agree with all those parties being involved in it, but I'd be sure that we'd come up with a firm protocol on how to handle these things. So there's no question what we expect from behavior from students, teachers, and police when they're involved in these things. We know how to treat each one equally.
Okay, we've tried to explore some of these things. I think what we can see is that all these cases, there's our complex choices, and many times our knee-jerk reactions affect different people as we go down. And I think Aaron points out that we're not only dealing with the student who's the victim and the student who's the suspect, but we're dealing with everybody else who's watching this in their environment of learning. I want to thank our panel for their putting up with being put on the spot and for their insight, and thank you for your participation.
Many of you here who are principals and school superintendents may have individual experience that's equal to the individual experience of attendees here, but no one has this combined experience. And what we've clearly shown, and what I got out of it, is that they are complicated situations. They don't have easy answers, and there is never going to be a formula for managing these cases. It's always going to rely upon people whose hearts are in the right place, and people whose resources are available to them and have some kind of support in their community. We today have done something that nobody has yet done. There will now be many conferences around the country looking at these topics, I'm sure, and I know many of your communities have already had meetings in your communities, and some have fairly advanced programs for dealing with these situations. I don't expect soon, having looked at the list of attendees here, that there's going to be a group gathered like this somewhere, and I want to leave you with what my plans are and with a charge for how we can participate together. The first thing I commit to you is that we will stay in touch with every one of you and let you know what we are doing with the results of the contacts that have been developed here and the ideas that we've heard. Many people here have approached me today and suggested ideas, and I have got a whole pocket full of notes about things that I've heard here today, and I want to encourage you to do the same thing. My request to you would be stay in touch with us, stay in touch with each other. This entire group list is available to anyone who wants it, and we all have an opportunity to change the way America looks at these predictions. We really have that opportunity. I've seen it happen with Mosaic programs and domestic violence that change things all over the country because they take a different approach. We will certainly be, we this group together, the first group that produces something concrete by way of guidance and questions and hopefully even an actual instrument that Gil Garcetti was talking about. And so I want to close by thanking you all very much and letting you know that I am tremendously grateful. And so I thank you very much and wish you a good drive or flight home. Thanks.